Sitting Bull, the legendary American Indian chief. Popular myth has him leading his people to great victory at the Battle of Little Bighorn.
People jump to Sitting Bull as the cause, the mastermind, the Napoleon of the Indian race, one headline called him.
But archaeological evidence from the battle site, military analysis of how the conflict actually unfolded, and oral history passed down through generations paint a dramatically different picture. As we open the mystery files on Sitting Bull. June 5th, 1876. This hillside in eastern Montana sees one of the most iconic events in American history, the Battle of Little Bighorn. But ironically, the seeds of this brutal battle are sown in a peace accord. 8 years before the battle, a treaty is drawn up at Fort Laramie. The agreement between the U.S. government and the Lakota Nation gives the Indians control over an area of land, creating the Great Sioux Reservation. Crucially, it also gives them the so-called unceded land, a much larger region in which the Lakota can roam freely and hunt in their traditional fashion. Tim Lehman, history professor at the Rocky Mountain College.
They understood it as a way to preserve their way of life, at least for the foreseeable future, because it provided a large land base.
But in 1874, an expedition led by Lieutenant Colonel Custer enters the reservation and discovers gold ore in the Black Hills. News gets out, and the Lakota's land is invaded by white prospectors. Bill Yan has studied Sitting Bull's life.
This was a violation of the treaty, and it was one that the Lakota obviously took exception to.
This white incursion is deeply disturbing to the Lakota. To them, the Black Hills are sacred ground. The hills are the center of their universe. However, the government, unable to stem the tide of white settlers, tries to renegotiate the Laramie Treaty.
The U.S. government said, okay, well, you have your reservation, but we're going to have to take the Black Hills out of it.
The Lakota refuse, and the U.S. comes up with another plan. They will incite a war and take back the Black Hills as part of the spoils. On the 6th of December, 1875, the Bureau of Indian Affairs decree all Lakota people must now live within the bounds of the reservation, rather than hunting on the unceded land. To do this means the Lakota giving up their traditional nomadic lifestyle completely. If they don't, they will be considered hostile. The U.S. government knows for many this will be an impossible decision, and it will lead to strong resistance. Around this time, one Lakota man has emerged as a leader. He is known as Sitting Bull. Ernie LaPointe is his direct descendant.
Sitting Bull was my great-grandfather. He took care and cared for his people, and they listened to his advice, they listened to his counsel.
Up to this point, Sitting Bull has resisted contact with the U.S., and in 1875, he does not move to the reservation lands.
I think the main reasons why my great-grandfather resisted the government encroachment is that his ancestors lived a certain way of life, and they lived with the land. They didn't own it. And he could not understand why people wanted to own something that you cannot own.
He wanted most of all to be left alone. So as far as he was concerned, this was an unfair and unwarranted edict.
Sitting Bull and his people now become military targets. The army sends out battalions to scour the plains in search of these so-called hostile Indians. Leading three of these battalions is Lieutenant Colonel George Armstrong Custer. On the 25th of June, 1876, Custer's command discovers Sitting Bull's camp next to the Little Bighorn River. Custer's a brash and confident man. He's built a reputation as a fierce and effective fighter in the frontier wars. He assumes a surprise attack will lead to a resounding victory, but he is wrong. Military expert Robert Kershaw has come to the battlefield to analyze the event.
Custer wasn't reckless. He took risks, and risks are calculated options, and that is what he did. And he got them wrong, so he made a mistake, and he paid the ultimate penalty for that.
The risks he takes are drawn from his military knowledge, but crucially, he adapts them.
Custer is not thinking Civil War tactics. He feels he's got to surround the village in order for them not to run away.
Custer had attacked Indian villages before. On those occasions, the warriors had fled, getting the women and children to safety. To prevent this happening again, Custer splits up his force, sending Major Marcus Reno and his battalion directly at the village. Custer then takes his battalion east along the ridgeline to contain the village and make a coordinated attack with Reno.
It was almost one of those situations where you should be careful of what you hope for, you know. He wished they would stand and fight so that he could defeat them. They stood and fought, and the rest is history.
To Custer, this defiance in battle by Sitting Bull's people is something new.
It was completely unexpected. The Indians boil out of the village. They don't run, they actually attack. And they advance on the skirmish line and outflank it at both ends.
Many researchers believe the Lakota response is linked to a vision Sitting Bull had just days earlier.
He predicted Custer's attack and predicted that it would fail. And this raised the Indian morale immeasurably.
He felt that this vision he had at the Deer Medicine Rocks here was played a significant part in what the outcome of what's going to happen.
It was as if the will of heaven had been divined and heaven was on Lakota's side this time.
By splitting up his force in order to contain the fleeing enemy, Custer seriously weakens his attack. The Lakota and Cheyenne warriors push Reno into retreat. But it isn't just force of numbers and zeal inspired by Sitting Bull's vision that creates this turn in Lakota's favor. Sitting Bull's own gun, an 1866 Winchester rifle, provides a key clue. Douglas Scott excavated the battlefield site over several seasons between 1984 and 2010.
We were literally surprised the first day of our investigations by the quantity of materials that we were finding. In the first hour of the first day, we had 110 artifacts, and it grew to 5,000. We were able to, using firearms identification techniques, sort out the individual firearms to a certain degree.
Scott found plenty of Springfield rifle cartridges, which were the U.S. Cavalry standard issue gun. His great discovery is the weapons used by the Lakota and Cheyenne.
They were using some of the latest available firearms, the Winchester Model 1873, the Model 1866, and the Henry rifle, all of which are repeaters.
Through trading with frontier settlers, Sitting Bull and his people have gained some of the latest firearms. To determine their impact on the battle, Robert Kershaw goes to an armory fort to test the Lakotas' and the cavalry's firepower capabilities. First up is the cavalryman's rifle.
We'll take it from the first round fired, okay?
Kershaw wants to know the number of rounds each gun can fire in a minute. With the Springfield, the cavalrymen have to reload after each shot.
Right, that was seven.
Next up is the Henry repeater rifle.
Take the Henry.
Used by the Lakota and Cheyenne.
So when you're ready, you just carry on.
Certainly.
With the Henry, the Lakota can fire 12 rounds in quick succession before reloading.
That's pretty stark. That's at least four times faster than the Springfield. That's quite impressive.
The repeater rifles gave Sitting Bull's people the ability to fire over 24 rounds a minute, while the cavalrymen have only seven at best. Back in the battle, with Reno's command in retreat, Custer is left facing the full force of the Indian firepower. Having reached a route into the village, crossing the Little Bighorn River, Custer's men meet fierce resistance. And a push back. With more warriors and greater weaponry, it is easy to imagine the legendary Sitting Bull in a Napoleon-like role, leading his great army against the invaders. But the evidence here reveals this is simply untrue.
Custer's men fought in Civil War lines. The Indians fought as individuals. Custer appeared and they all set about him because he threatened their village, their very way of life. And Custer's command began to disintegrate and they treated it as a buffalo hunt. They would cut out the weaker elements from the herd, the weaker companies, and they would take them out.
The secret of success for Sitting Bull's people is their skilled guerrilla-style fighting.
There was no military organization, as the history books say. It's just that every individual knew how to protect the village. The men, they fought their own style of fight, and they fought on their own ground, and they knew what they were doing. They knew the terrain.
Surrounded by Lakota and Cheyenne warriors, the cavalry is unable to regroup. Custer and all his soldiers are cut down.
268 men had died in a single engagement. Now that represented 1% of the much reduced American Army's establishment after the American Civil War. The equivalent today of some 6,000 American soldiers dying unexpectedly overnight. So the nation was incredibly shocked.
To rationalize this surprising defeat, the US media creates a dramatic tale of heroes and villains, with Sitting Bull and Custer taking center stage.
Custer had previously been created as kind of a media hero. He was like a central casting archetype of this glorious Indian fighter. And when he died, the battle in which he died, gloriously, of course, it had to be important. Because Custer was such a glamorous figure, he had to have had as his nemesis in this pivotal battle somebody of equal or corresponding mystique.
The media builds the myth of Sitting Bull by molding him as a mirror image of Custer, a Lakota military strategist, and turning the battle into the perfect showdown between Indian savagery and U.S. civilization. Sitting Bull becomes the USA's public enemy number one, soon after known as a remorseless and implacable savage because of a conflict that lasted a matter of hours. But the military analysis has revealed that Sitting Bull could not have been the war chief at Little Bighorn. The success of the Lakota is down to their own individual fighting skills and personal courage. And now there is, in fact, new evidence that suggests Sitting Bull was never on the battlefield at all.
Sitting Bull was present at the Little Bighorn, but he was not a combatant.
Ernie LaPointe carries with him his family's oral history. The Lakota recorded their past as spoken word, transferred from one generation to another. This evidence, held secret for generations, exposes some key information about Sitting Bull's life.
He really wasn't in the battle, you know, because when he was going to join the battle and came out of his teepee, his mother was standing outside the door and she stopped him. And she told him, she said, you know, she told him, son, she said, you have done enough with these people. You have protected, provided for them, and cared for them. She says, now, she said, let the younger ones, younger men, prove their worth in protecting the village. She says, you need to take care of the young, the elderly. And she says, you have wives and children, you need to protect them.
While Sitting Bull had been a respected warrior in his youth, by the time of the battle, now in his mid-40s, he plays a different but no less crucial role.
He was actually a sun dancer for his people. And he lived for the existence of his culture and his people.
Sitting Bull is a spiritual guide, a sun dancer, as well as a caretaker or leader for his people. The sun dance, or Wiwang Wisipi, is one of the Lakota's most sacred rituals.
Well, sun dance, in the first place, is a ceremony for the people. You give your blood, sweat, and tears. You give your blood, you know, for the people to live and for the future generations to be born and for the elders to have longer lives. So through storytelling, they can tell the children the culture.
Sitting Bull is the sun dancer for the annual ceremony in 1876, just days before the great battle.
When my great-grandfather came here, his sun dance was, the sun dance arena was built right over in that area. And the camp was back up in here, in that, around the edge of there. And this is where he performed his flesh offering, which he gave 50 pieces of flesh from his arm.
The ritual is extremely arduous and painful, leading to great personal sacrifice for the spiritual benefit of the tribe. The Lakota believe it induces a vision sent by the Great Spirit. This is when Sitting Bull had his vision of victory, which so inspired the Lakota braves. The vision showed soldiers falling in their camp upside down or dead. This much has been known for some time, but the vision also came with a warning.
He said, do not take their belongings. In other words, don't take their food, their clothes, scalps, nothing. Just leave them as they lay.
It is a warning that those on the battlefield did not follow. As skeletal remains discovered during Douglas Scott's excavations reveal.
We did find that, in actuality, that many of these soldiers had just extensive cut marks, blunt force trauma and sharp force trauma, which in our modern cultural context we'd call mutilation. We have to put that in a cultural perspective to what that means. Most of it is probably very simply a cultural expression that the Lakota and Cheyenne had of marking their vanquished foe.
They believed people traveled to the afterlife in the condition they left the earth. They disfigured their enemies to prevent them from enjoying the spirit world. However, at Little Bighorn, some think the Lakota and Cheyenne also acted out of anger towards the U.S. soldiers.
It was a brutal war, and the most brutal parts of that war, to me, the most heart-wrenching, are the winter campaigns, where the Army attacked Cheyenne and Lakota villages in the dead of winter. And in one case, babies froze to death at their mother's breasts.
Previous battles had seen the indiscriminate killing of Lakota men, women, and children at the hands of these U.S. soldiers.
Those who had lost the most friends, relatives, and family members were the ones who were most active in mutilating bodies at the Little Bighorn.
The anger is perhaps understandable, but LaPointe believes the Lakota cursed themselves on that day for ignoring his great-grandfather's advice, and that Sitting Bull knew this.
He prayed for the fallen, his warriors who died there. Plus, he also prayed for Custer and his men, you know, that, you know, they fought bravely, you know, even though they all died. But he also prayed for the sanctity of his people. What they'd done went against the vision of Wakantunka, so he knew they were going to suffer at the hands of the relatives of these soldiers who died here, you know, in the future.
In revenge for the battle, Sitting Bull and his people are hunted for years.
He didn't really want to fight. He was just defending. He was never the aggressor because he was always being pursued by the government's troops. So, but he was always protecting and defending a way of life in this land.
Unlike the legend, Sitting Bull took no part in the fighting at Little Bighorn. He stayed back to protect the women and children. The individual ability of each Lakota warrior and Custer's own miscalculations are the reasons behind the historic outcome. An outcome that, for the Lakota, is bittersweet, as perhaps Sitting Bull had anticipated. The expansion of the United States is inevitable, and when government policy destroys the buffalo herds, the Plains Indians begin to starve. Sitting Bull's own surrender comes nearly 5 years after the Battle of Little Bighorn in 1881, when he finally gives up his traditional lifestyle and succumbs to living on the reservation.
Brand new Mystery Files is back at 7 p.m. on Monday. Next tonight, We Built the Titanic pays tribute to the ship's engineers.